Good afternoon. My name is Debbie Sharma. I'm the chairperson of the Lord Selkirk West Caledonian Community Committee, and I'd like to bring our meeting of today, October 11th, 2016, to order. Joining me today is Councillor Ross Eady from the Minarski Ward. We have from the Planning Department Noah Yawk and Femi Ojo. We have Inspector Barry Kostuk with us, as well as Clerk Kate McMillan. Councillor Eady, would you move the minutes?
I move the minutes of our September the 13th, was it?
Yeah.
Yep.
September 13th. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carry. We start with delegations. Inspector Kostuk, thanks for being with us here today.
Madam yes. Chairperson, Councillor Pactican will be here later, right? He's
yes.
in the middle of another city meeting.
That's right. He will be joining us around 4:30, I believe. Okay. Inspector Kostuk, thanks for being with us
thanks
here today.
Thanks for having me again.
Do you have any update?
Yeah.
And we'll take questions, our regular routine.
Sure. Just to give you a snapshot of some recent going-ons in Division 13. We had a bit of a spike in break-ins in recent weeks throughout the district, residential, commercial, garage, sheds, that sort of thing. Recently arrested four separate individuals for a total of 12 break-ins. Fairly active, so I'm hoping that, and in fact, as you'll see in a few minutes, that we've been able to reverse this trend to some degree. Vehicle break-ins, that's not stolen vehicles, that's break-ins to vehicles for stealing items out of the vehicles. Those were up in recent weeks as well. No discernible pattern there, just scattered throughout the division. But it's usually valuables left in sight. There was a public service announcement out today reminding citizens to keep their valuables hidden, doors locked, et cetera, park in well-lit areas, et cetera. So hopefully that'll have a bit of an impact on those type of incidents as well.
Does this involve smashed windows?
Yeah, smashed windows usually. It's quite often people will leave their vehicles open too. You'll get individuals that will troll through parking lots, down back alleys, and just try doors. And if the doors are left unlocked, they'll go through and try and look for pocket change and that sort of thing. Recently added some special initiative hotspots to our files. We had a rash of arsons in the 600 block of Aberdeen and Redwood about 3 weeks ago. So we've been paying some special attention to that area, as well as a rash of break-ins about 3 weeks ago to the St. John's North Point Douglas area. Again, we're paying special attention to those areas, and they have dropped off. As you're aware in the media, fentanyl and carfentanyl cases are on the rise, very dangerous drugs that not only pose a risk to the citizens of Winnipeg, but also to first responders, police officers that are responding to these incidents. Certainly the service takes this very seriously, and we're looking at ways to mitigate the risk as this develops to both our members and members of the public. School zone traffic enforcement, now that the school year has started again, our divisional traffic units are paying special attention to these areas. Just a quick snapshot on our crime trends. We're down pretty much across the board division-wise. Break and enters are down 39% from the previous week and down 7% from the same week last year. Robberies are down 11% from the previous week, but increased 33% over the same period last week. That encompasses all types of robberies, commercial robberies, strong-arm robberies, muggings, that sort
of
thing.
That's over last year.
That's over last year, yeah, but down 11% over the previous week. Stolen vehicles are down 38% both from the previous week this year and last year, and theft from motor vehicles are down 29% from the same week last from the previous week this year, and 14% down over last year. Overall, division-wide, we're down 27% from the previous week and down 2% from the same time last year. So looking fairly well as far as trends go. Mm-hmm. And that's all I have for now. Any questions?
Thank you. Any questions, Councillor Eady?
Sure. I had a meeting with the fire department as well. Seems to be random or whatever. Some are discovered the cause and that sort of stuff in terms of arson, but and I know it's not really your oversight, but when you put together these areas which you're trying to watch for when these fires are happening. Is there communication with like the school resource officers in the area and stuff like that?
I know that's done through Turnabout and programs such as that through our community relations and our school resource program. As far as reaching out for specific incidents, I'm not aware of that, not to say that that couldn't be done. But at this point, I know we haven't, specific to this incident that I was referring to. I can't speak to that. I don't know if that was done or not.
Okay. I was wondering about that. And the danger to the officers, not, I mean, there's all kinds of dangers to the officers and to the fire paramedics. But so did I hear right in the news that this cofentanil, if you even like touch it, it can get into your system?
Well, I think with carfentanil, it's a derivative of fentanyl, which is basically an opioid drug that is a...
knocks down elephants.
Well, yeah, the carfentanil version of it. Yeah, it's as the scale goes, I think fentanyl is about 100 times more potent than morphine as a painkiller, and then carfentanil is again, about 100 times more potent than regular fentanyl. We are seeing carfentanil, not that fentanyl is dangerous enough, but carfentanyil is being, we are making seizures of it. It's becoming more and more prevalent, and it seems to have started out west in BC and moved east. But yes, my understanding is that very minute amounts can be fatal if ingested. Again, it can be ingested through the skin, it can be inhaled, it can be injected. So my understanding is that carfentanyl, an amount the size of a grain of salt, is enough to kill a person. So very dangerous stuff. Yeah.
I just wanted to draw your attention to Red River Community Center. Yes. We are installing gates. They may possibly have been installed last week, but I appreciate your help in creating the hotspot and monitoring around there. But I think it might alleviate, obviously, the problem of the cars congregating at night. So the gates will be installed shortly if you wanted to let your team know.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Thank you. And my assistant, Dale Wilson, he's new. He's worked in my office for a year, and I don't think he's had the opportunity to meet you. Mm-hmm. So we were just chatting this afternoon if we could have a meeting offline. And there's some more issues that he wanted to bring forward to you. Okay. Thank you. Anything further, Councillor Reedy?
I just wanted to thank the inspector and all the people that work for him that I think staying on top of things. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. We can move on to the next delegation. That would be Maples Community Center to give us an update on a new building project and expansion to the existing Maples Community Center. If you could please come forward, Derek Dabby and company.
Yes.
Okay, you can all come forward to the end of the table there.
Three of us will make a brief presentation. And
sure.
Others will maybe indulge to present.
Sure, if you could just sit on the other end of the table because that way the microphone will record you.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. And feel free to introduce the others you brought with you into the gallery.
First of all, a very good afternoon to everyone, councillors and officials, civic officials. My name is Derek Davey, president of the Maples Community Center, and we are proud today to present our great vision for a new and unique community center, unique yet sustainable. And at this time, I will say briefly that Mr. John Fischer will present our case in a few minutes, or only a few minutes long, and then Cal will support him, I'm sure, capably as we do usually. And I'm proud to also announce that Lisa Jaboto is here with us as the delegation, and Mr. Manny Onaris, Mr. Basketball himself, Commissioner of the North American PBA.
And Manny's from what organization?
The Philippine Basketball. North American League. And of course, Tom Barrett somewhere here, hiding. Tom Barrett from the Naples Community Center. So, once again, thanks. We are really proud to present our story today, but I'll take 30 seconds to say we have done all the judicious and reasonable and intense study to present this vision for northwest of Winnipeg, matter of fact, for all Winnipeg. And meet the needs of the community centers and the surrounding area. We are proud to announce that we have 2 years ago started the collective design process. This was a grant was done by awarded us by the province of Manitoba, and we hired three architects to do the assessment study. And we have all that with the guidance of WGCWCC They have done all that, and today we have an excellent business plan and vision for a new community center. So I will just be happy to tell you that Mr. John Ortiz and Mr. Kyle Taylor will do the honors of present our brief plan to you today.
Excellent. So please tell us about your project, and that way it's on the public record, and we know what you're working towards as a community.
Thank you. Councillor Sharma and Councillor Eady, my name is Joe Nachita, and I'm here to make a brief presentation with aid of PowerPoint, and for Mr. Eady's, Councillor Eady's benefit, it's all talking points on my PowerPoint presentation, so you'll be hearing all of it. But as Derek said, we're very proud to be here. We think the vision for the Maples Recreation Association and the new community center is an ambitious presentation, and the factors that have contributed to the creation of this vision is the age and condition and useful life of the current Maples Community Club. It's very old. We've had some engineers look at it, and basically their advice was that it's a teardown, the current community center, because of its aging condition. Also, the substantial population increase and anticipated future growth of the Maples area, that the area requires more recreation and cultural space, and so that's one of the goals. With that, the lack of adequate indoor recreation, cultural and meeting places for the community, and the desire of the community and area residents to have an easily accessible multi-use recreation facility that can be used by all. And also, is a big part of this, biggest part of this the new community center is going to be indoor court facilities, and there is a recognition that indoor court facilities are generally lacking in the immediate area as well as the city of Winnipeg. So I was tasked by the Maples Recreation Association to prepare a business plan for them, and the purpose of this of the business plan was to, one, determine the demand for a regional indoor hardwood field house to serve the Maples District, surrounding areas, and ultimately the city of Winnipeg as a whole. Now, we have seen development of indoor soccer facilities in the city, and those were definitely needed, and there's been two large ones now with U of M and recently in the Garden City area, as I'm sure you all know. But now this is an indoor hardwood field house, which is something that's highly needed in the city. So this is what we're after here. So also, in the business plan, we wanted to refine the design for the expansion of the community center, including the addition of the indoor hardwood field house. And this was to meet the priorities of the Maples Recreation Association, the community, and user groups. Also in the business plan, we were tasked with providing the best estimates of capital costs of the facility, and then to create an operation schedule for the facility that would determine operating hours, rate structure, availability for user groups, and for community programming. Finally, the business plan provided a revenue and expense projection for the facility and a pro forma statement of operations, and then that would determine the economic viability and sustainability of the facility.
Joe, could I just say a couple of words?
Yep.
I just wanted to interject a little bit here, and that's that basketball is the number one sport with registered participants from ages 12 to 17 right now. It's really rapidly growing, and we see a real need in our area and in Manitoba and Winnipeg as a whole. Since 2010, there has been better than a 16% growth in basketball registration in Canada. It's outpacing hockey, soccer.
So, as Cal mentioned, the primary use of the spec facility will be basketball, based on the feedback we've had from the provincial bodies and all the user groups we've talked to. But we want to stress that it's also more than a basketball facility. It'll have, there's obviously volleyball, badminton, and it'll have a 300-meter running walking track, which will be the biggest indoor track in the city of Winnipeg right now. There's a fitness area. We have multi-purpose rooms that will accommodate cultural events and much, much more. So, as we said, to be more formal, the functions of this multiplex is that it will be the new home of the Maples Community Center, with community club offices, boardroom, meeting rooms, with expanded and improved amenity spaces that will enhance the programming that is currently provided by the community center. A large multi-purpose room with kitchen that can accommodate up to 600 people. Then the multi-use sporting and recreational field house will contain 8 hardwood gymnasium courts with a running walking track on the second level surrounding the gymnasium. The second floor will contain a fitness center, administration and rental offices, and viewing areas into the gymnasium. And this new facility will be attached to the existing hockey facility, creating an integrated functional facility.
And presently, in our north end of the city, anyways, there's very minimal FIBA-sized basketball courts. And what we mean by that we can host international tournaments, national tournaments, because the 8 courts will be official size. In many of the community centers in our region, you can't do that right now.
So, as another point, there's not many of these facilities in the country. There's only one that's close to it, it's actually larger than this one, and it's the Saddle Center in Edmonton, Alberta, and it's located on the University of Alberta campus. And I had the pleasure to attend the facility and meet with the manager for a day and a half there, and we discussed many things that helped in our concept for this facility. But some of the factors that they use and that we definitely plan to have with our facility here is the success factors are that the facility affords the creation of opportunities for all ages and abilities, that it has spaces that encourage social interaction, it has times available for activities that are scheduled as well as spontaneous. It includes convenience amenities in the space, such as meeting rooms, kitchen, NPR rooms, food service, etc. It allows for multi-purpose spaces and expandability of these spaces based on the event, and it does have accommodation for special events as well as local and national competitions when it comes to sports. And it will integrate indoor and outdoor environments because the soccer fields and baseball fields are surrounding the building. So that's what we hope to achieve. So capital costs of the project, these are in $2,015, but we've already made provisions for 2017 prices on it. But the 2015 prices, including the consultants, the soft costs, construction costs, and equipment costs, totaled $21,145,900. We have increased that amount for today's purposes by 10%, which takes into account a 5% increase per year in construction costs. The actual amount that I've gotten from construction consultants is 4%, but we've done 5% a year to be safe. So what is the expected funding that the Maples Recreation Association is looking for this project? We're looking at, from all three levels of government, the federal, the provincial, and Winnipeg, and the city of Winnipeg, we're looking for $7 million from each level of government, for a total of $21 million in funding from government. And the MRA's funding contribution is that we are committed to fundraising and or borrowing capital in the amount of up to $3 million to complete the funding for the MRA multiplex. So our maximum financing of $3 million at a 3% interest rate over a 25-year amortization would cost the MRA $170,000 a year. And based on the current pro forma statements, the MRA is able to support this level of financing. So the money aside and the funding aside, and we've got that under control. I think one of the things that is important for this facility and what this facility can contribute to the city of Winnipeg are the economic impacts. By far, all the user groups that we talked to at the province, at Sport Manitoba, stated that the largest area of potential for the facility such as this is the ability to hold national and international tournaments. That's something Winnipeg has a lot of trouble doing. Just as an aside, I'll give you an example. The Manitoba Volleyball Association hosted a national tournament last year in November, I believe it was. It was held at the convention center, and they had to truck a gymnasium floor from Alberta, set it up, maintain it during the tournament because it does move around, and then after the tournament was over, load it back up into the truck and get it back to Alberta. Huge costs. Doesn't make sense to have a tournament, really, they say, but because they're obligated by the National Association, and as basketball, volleyball, badminton, every sport is somewhat obligated by the national associations to hold tournaments, and this facility would solve all their problems because it's a big enough facility to hold a large tournament, and it's all under one roof, and so obviously economic benefits are lost to our community and to the city due to the lack of facilities for hosting such tournaments and competitive events. These are exciting events for participants as well as spectators, and they can draw many visitors to our city from the cities of the teams coming in. For example, a national club volleyball or basketball tournament that would attract 100 teams has the ability to generate more than $5 million in economic impact into our community. And obviously, with a facility such as this can occur several times a year. So one of the other advantages we have is that this multiplex would be located in the center of Canada, in Winnipeg. So again, it's a natural venue for a countrywide tournament. So we can potentially become the tournament capital of Canada. So in conclusion, the MRA multiplex represents an exciting future for both the Maples community and for the city of Winnipeg. It will be home to a first-class community, cultural, and sporting facility operating year-round, thereby enhancing the range of social and recreational opportunities for the community. There is unparalleled support for this multiplex by the community at large and the sport and cultural organizations that will make this facility their home. The financial projections for the MRA multiplex are very positive, showing that an operating surplus will be achieved in its initial year of operation with continuing growth thereafter. And as my final line is, there is no better time to act on this exciting development than now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Do you have anything else to add?
Just a couple points. In the Maples area alone, and it's been, I think, about 25 years, there's been no significant cultural or developed it in our area for 25 years. Our community center is very old. So I think that for our center and our region, we're due for some support. The Maples, right from the onset, has been following our due diligence and the appropriate process through all of this, starting with open houses a number of times for our community to listen and design something that they wanted. We've respected the process at all levels of government, and we're working through what has been provided to us by, again, the three levels of government, and we're looking for that support now more than ever.
Well, thank you very much for the presentation. Councillor Pactican from the Point Douglas Ward has joined us, and he's familiar with the project. I know he's had meetings with the group here. I have been present at some of them. So there's a package that's been circulated here to us. So I think today was an opportunity to get on the public record, Councillor Pactican, and share their project with us that you're familiar with. Could I just ask a question in terms of, you mentioned this isn't just going to be a basketball facility by any means. What are the other user groups? Can you just recap that again?
Yeah, we've talked to basically every group in the sport Manitoba: volleyball, basketball, badminton, wheelchair athletics.
Tennis was one of them. Yes, yeah, tennis.
Oh yeah, yeah. Tennis, table tennis. I've got them all in the business planner. Yeah.
So these groups, they have a lack of space. They all do.
The biggest, basically, what I got from we sent out a survey. They filled the survey out for us, and their biggest the biggest thing holding the associations back in terms of sport was lack of facilities. Now, of course, everyone wants their facilities in prime time, you know, or on weekends, but there's barely enough facilities for them to get their sports, their league programs into. But another big point that was mentioned is they have no practice facilities. So instead of you play a game once a week, but there's a huge need for training and for practicing, and there's nothing available for it. So this opens up the possibilities. But again, we even had judo, karate, yoga, dance.
Can we have arm wrestling?
Sure. I'm sure you can. Dance instruction, you know, dance studio, dance instruction.
Sure. The possibilities are endless.
The geography also is the key here as well.
And soccer, there for futsal, there's even though we have the indoor soccer facilities, that a gymnasium facility would be suitable for them as well.
Sure. You could have one group doing basketball on one side, you have badminton on the other. You could have you know, three different sports going at once.
Yeah. The areas would be curtained off, right?
Yep.
Yes.
Now, can we talk again about the economic impact?
Comes in before you go, we just want to miss, we may have missed one little item. It's a big item, the social, community, cultural aspect. We have made enormous, you know, accommodation for that entity, and that seniors, young people, even right now we have expectant mother, we have free seminars every week there. That would be go with multifold, that young people can come have concerts and events there. So that the two gyms that we're having, it'll be just a traditional community center with a social, cultural, multicultural impact. Anyway, carry on.
Absolutely. So now back to the economic impact. We're seeing missed opportunities that other cities are scooping up the national and international tournaments. There's lots of opportunity, you're saying, for that?
Like absolutely.
You pegged $5 million. You threw that number out.
Yeah. Well, we've got a representative from the Philippine Basketball Association. He can explain to you that there's a tournament that's coming up that we could host. Manny, can you speak to that?
I represent the...
Come on here to the delegation.
The commissioner, not any rep.
This is just one example.
Hi, Russ. I just recently got elected in the Filipino Basketball Association of North America, and we are scheduled here to host in 2020. We bring more than 100 teams all over of North America, and it really gives a big economic impact in the city. And
And we're not able to do that right now because we don't have the proper facilities.
Right.
And Joe, you mentioned that we at the convention center years ago did host something, but floor had to be trucked in.
That's right.
And it was
It's not economically feasible to host a large tournament due to the fact that we don't have an integrated facility. I mean, they do. Don't get me wrong. Tournaments are hosted here, but if in a gymnasium setting, you're using six or seven different venues. And they're, you know, they're not, the courts aren't always the same or are not of the same quality. It just doesn't lend itself to hosting a, you know, when you host a tournament, you want to you want this our city to be represented well and to say we have great facilities, and this will get teams to come back, and this facility will afford us that. And that's from this, a lot of this, especially volleyball and basketball. Mm-hmm. You know, they have national competitions in every age group every year. And they get different cities to host that. There's no reason why we couldn't, why Winnipeg with a facility like this couldn't host, you know, half a dozen of those tournaments a year, and club tournament, club national championships. It's the opportunities are endless. We don't know about it. In speaking with the manager of the Saddle Center, they host a lot of our national tournaments because they have the ability to do so, and it's easy for the national body. You know, when their employees are looking at hosting a tournament, they're going to go to the facility that's going to make their life easiest for them.
Right.
You know, they don't want to be spending hours and hours organizing buses and et cetera, et cetera. Right.
The logistics side of a tournament as well, and scheduling and the number of days it would involve, it also comes into play because we have so many courts. Mm-hmm. But just another example is that Manny will speak to, he's got 117 teams presently that he's trying to fit into a couple of buildings. So their season runs...
Yeah, I actually have a little bit of a dilemma right now. We have one gym taken away from us at the Garden City because... They got a new project on the other one, so I don't know where to bring my. I have to turn registrations down because I just can't.
That's Maple's people. Be farming them out.
Mm-hmm. So we hear your point loud and clear about the local community need, and then the economic impact, the dollars that could be generated for our city and our province. Mm-hmm. You mentioned other levels of government that you would be looking for $7 million, hopefully, from each level of government. Have you had conversations with the federal government and the provincial government?
Yeah, I'll say briefly we did, and we have made inroads in the previous provincial government. They have awarded us $7 million. However, now the new government is assessing it, but therefore we have to regroup and redo. But we have been meeting for the last 9 months, federal, provincial, civic officials, and they have been very careful and positive. Because that's a hard question, but very supportive. The city answer is yes. And lastly, just to touch base on what Carl almost said, we are the fastest growing quad in the city of Winnipeg. And that facility and the demographics are growing. We are meeting a need, and maybe a few more hotels would even build.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks.
Almost guaranteed.
Are there any questions, councillors? I do want to give kudos to Councillor Pactican because he raised the issue of a facility that's needed for basketball. It was a few years ago. I remember you put the comments
visionary
on the table, and so here we are today, and you've put this huge plan together, and it's about dollars, really, and making sure that we can collaborate with other levels to get something like this done, because one partner can't do it alone. Mm-hmm. Councillor Pactican?
Yeah, thank you very much, Madam Chair, and thank you all for coming here today and making a public delegation regarding the new Maples Community Centre multiplex. I think it's fantastic, and just to piggyback off what Councillor Sharma was saying, the city really does need a multi-court basketball center, and this is a great vision that you guys are developing with the plans and your business plan. My question is, in terms of the actual site, the actual land itself, have you guys done any, I don't know what you call it, like geotechnical core testing to see if the land is suitable? There's no environmental requirements. Are there any mineral rights? I just want to know what kind of due diligence you've done.
Actually, Tom can
just to make sure that everything's smooth on that.
Tom, you'll have to come to the table here.
Join us.
And it's on the record. We'll get you to speak into the microphone.
Thanks, Ben.
Yeah. Thank you for having us today. Yeah, indeed, we did do a geotechnical survey on the last round of our professional cost and feasibility study, so that is available.
And you found there's no issues regarding environmental or mineral rights or anything like that?
Correct. Yeah, the issue was it's a long span structure, and they wanted to make sure the soil could support the weight of it. So they did come out, they bored big holes in there, and they sent it off to the engineers and scientists, and they came back and gave us a detailed study.
That's a good question.
The only reason I ask is because the new soccer complex had some issues with it built in an old landfill site, so no one knew that at the time, so I just was asking to make sure there's no unforeseen things that occur. Sometimes those are the ones that occur underground.
Good question.
Yeah, it did come back clear. So
excellent.
Anything further, councillors? Okay, Councillor Reedy.
Good to hear about this. See, this is totally like regional, citywide. Right?
Yes, sir.
It's really great. The first, I just had a question though. The Maples Community Center itself, what's the catchment area for that? That goes all the way up in Amber Trails and Meadows West.
Oh, yes.
All the way spending daily.
The perimeter. And
perimeter
west,
to north.
West to King Edward,
McPhillips,
south, Inkster and McPhillips.
Amber Trails is inherited, right?
Oh,
because
yes,
it's
inherited.
Growing.
No, it's just the next step. Anyway, I think this is a great idea. You guys did talk to me a little bit earlier as well, but anyway. So this sounds to me, Councilman Practicum, sounds like we had this, the city itself had this idea where it would work with the Ys. I think what they built in Calgary was, there's a YMCA big facility as well or whatever, but I'm just wondering if this, some of the money from the city wouldn't come, because the vision was for Northwest Winnipeg eventually. Was some kind of huge regional facility, something
right.
like this.
I think the point of today is they wanted to be on the public record and make sure they have a chance to come in before the councillors and just share the vision and yeah. just get in front of us yeah. and perhaps go on to the Standing Policy Committee on Protection where you would hear this again, Councillor Eady.
Yes. Well,
yeah.
And
are you interested in making
there is
the
a master.
Yes,
yeah. Yeah.
Thank
and
you.
And you're familiar with
protocol.
Anyway, when it comes to parks, community services, we'll do it. Our chairperson's right
yes.
here.
Yeah.
yeah.
I just some other questions. You know, I just wanted to say to you all, I talked to this fellow by the name of Dave Brazier some maybe 18, 20 years ago, and the vision for this site where they put the school and the swimming pool and all that, right? It was to be this huge regional facility, but somehow there was a breakdown between the city and school division in terms of developing this place for recreation, education, and so on, right? So I think it's great, and you're bringing the actual indoor track idea back, because underneath the Maples was supposed to be originally an indoor track. So I like the idea here. So you've also had, in developing this business plan, talk to the Seven Oaks School Division. I think Derek, you're
yes.
still on this.
We give them a letter of intent of using all the free spot or the unused spot. You take it up.
They're going to rent it.
They rent it.
They will. They'll
yep.
utilize it.
We have
yes.
a letter from them.
You do have a letter
yes.
supporting. So that's a revenue stream, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's really
yeah,
important.
I've submitted a business, a condensed version of the business plan with letters of support from all the major users. And as well as some of the financial institution that would like to give us a loan to do this project, and it has all the financial information on there.
Did you build into here maybe some kind of loan guarantee through the city of Winnipeg? Or?
Well, that's they understand that that's what occurs with projects such as these. So.
And you also looked at the sponsorship. Capabilities?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
yeah.
So that's part of when you say you can generate $170,000 a year, that's all factored in.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
And Mr. Tom Barrack is the point person in that area, by the way. He's recently established, he worked for us before.
Cool.
Yeah, the business plan is quite detailed and concise in terms of all those area revenue and expense generation.
Great. Can I ask you one favor?
Sure.
If you're able to, would you be able to email me your electronic copies?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Thanks.
I'll get your information from
and
you.
And just then. To the delegation, I know you expressed interest to also come before the Standing Committee on
yes,
Protection
please.
And Community Services. I see that the next meeting is this Friday at 9 o'clock. I don't know, perhaps we can try to get you on that agenda. Councillor Practicum, the chair is here.
Councillor Practicum, do you want to make the motion to?
Sure, we can.
Because then it would go to.
We can deal with that later, but just checking on your availability.
Okay. You make yourself
the 9 o'clock.
And I see Camtor Roy
yes.
Singh here, another
yes.
supporter of this project in the galleries, just come in a short
yes.
while ago.
Yes.
Welcome. Okay, so would your group be available
yes,
perhaps
we are.
On this Friday?
We concur.
At 9 o'clock, I believe it would be in this committee room or the one over.
9 o'clock across there?
It's either in this committee room.
This one?
Okay.
Yeah.
Just for us, AM or PM?
It would be in the morning.
AM. We'll be happy to come.
Once we can find parking.
Yes.
I think so we can make that motion later today.
Okay, later today. You don't, but we,
or we can deal
we with signal we will be happy to come.
I move to suspend the rules.
Okay,
I think
so we'll
Councillor Patkam would like to move a motion.
Okay. Great, so we'll do that right now while you're here.
Question on the rule suspension. Question on suspension.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
So, with regards to your presentation here today, again, thank you on behalf of all members of the committee here. I think it's fantastic the work that you've done. Obviously, you put together a big team of stakeholders, and the folks around the table here put a lot of work into it, a lot of volunteer time and other kinds of time. So, we'd like to ensure that the ball keeps rolling with regards to this project. And we have a meeting coming up of Protection Community Services and Parks this coming Friday. So if you have time, we would like for you to make a delegation at the meeting on Friday. So you're currently not on the agenda because the agenda is already published, so we'd have to move suspension of the rules, but I'm confident that we could probably do that to hear you. So the motion today would be that the LSWK recommend that the Maples Community Center folks appear in delegation at the Friday, October 14th meeting.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. So you accept?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank
and I'll you. Ask the clerk to add you to the agenda. Could you do that for them, Kate?
I'm going to go see who's the
okay, wonderful. She's already done it.
Thank you. We want to thank everybody, and we want to conspicuously announce Mr. Kantaroy Singh on the delegate. He, as a matter of diversity, and he's Mr. Cricket, is much more than basketball. So and he's always a big supporter. Any last word, delegate?
Nope, just thank you for the time.
And
really
you'll,
appreciate
you'll,
it.
You'll bring your PowerPoint on Friday as well,
yeah.
Because
yeah.
That was a very good presentation.
Thank you.
Okay, and you'll email Councillor Reedy a copy. Thank you.
I'll need Councillor Reedy's contact information.
Remember, readinessence at winnipeg.ca. R-E-A-D-I-E, readinessence at winnipeg.ca.
Thank you for your presence today.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll get it from Debbie's office.
Okay. Have a good night.
No further delegations, Madam Clerk?
We have one.
Okay. Oh, right. Okay. So this was the plan approval from last time that we laid over because of the bike racks, etc. So could I suspend the rules to have him come forward?
I can suspend the rules on your behalf.
So all in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Mr. Mailman, if you could come forward. Now, it's not on the agenda, the item. It was missed. So... Okay. And do the planners have the information for us again?
What address again?
Southeast corner.
If you could sit at the end, maybe I think that microphone is definitely on.
Oh, this is the one with the apartment block they're building.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh yeah. Right.
Remember it?
Yeah. It looks good.
Thank you. Okay. Hi, Chris. Thanks for coming all the way from BC.
No problem. Thank you for having me.
So we had some questions specifically around bike racks,
yep.
Accessibility,
yep.
The sidewalks, etc. So, Femi, did you want to sort of tell us where we left off with that, or?
Basically, the plan was approved for a foundation, but I guess there were some questions about the bike rack or fencing or parking. And the wood fence. So Chris is here to share some light on some of these requirements.
Right.
Yeah.
So do you have any plans for bike racks on
yeah.
the site?
Again, thank you for having me. If you guys aren't sure if you have the set of plans or site plan in front of you, but there is for bike racks, we've allocated three different areas within the site, kind of one section per building. Each bike rack typically holds 10 bikes, so there's storage for 30 bikes on the site, and they are, if you look, they're in the building B, they're in the left, right, top right corner. They're kind of shown in the corner of these sidewalks with a kind of a little bit of a black line. So they would be shown
right here.
Sorry.
It's on page 4.
Page 4, sir. With the side so it would be A1-0 on the site plan. If you go to that one.
Okay.
And the
so the second
drawing
page?
Number is on, yeah, second page, sorry.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so they are located, they're shown in a square with kind of a dashed line across it, almost looks like stitches. And there'd be one per building.
Where is it?
I could have brought the site plan to put up on the screen. My apologies.
You said second page. Is that new?
No.
Is that just put in? It was always there?
No.
Yeah, they were always there, but unless you kind of know what you're looking for, they'd be hard to find.
Where? Here? That little one. Okay. What is the plan for over here? What is it? So it's on page L-1?
Oh, here it is. Okay, sorry. Page what? 5? Okay, there we are. Oh, there? Okay.
So there's two areas for bike rack?
Three.
Three?
Three, okay. One per building.
Okay. Good. And what were the other questions? I know, Councillor Eady, the three of us all.
We were concerned about the accessibility getting around into the buildings itself.
Right.
All the doors are at grade, right?
Multifamily units? All the front doors are fully accessible. So they will either have, they're either at grade or will have provided ramps for accessibility, and then they also have the buttons for automatic openers as well.
I know we're just looking at the external stuff, but.
Yeah, and then obviously per building, there's three accessible stalls per building located right in the front. And then I believe there was a question on fencing. And then we have a 6-foot wood privacy fence along what would be the north and west property lines. So it would be between us and the neighboring multifamily, and then the commercial site that would be to the west of us.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so is this what it's going to look like from the outside?
Yes.
Is this the color scheme?
That's the color scheme. So that would be as to 3D rendering, and then the actual built materials would be on the in the architecturals, in the A3-1, it actually calls up the actual product names, but this would be an architectural rendering based on what the colors would be. Yes.
How many units again?
This site has 178 units on it.
And it's apartments?
Apartment rentals, yes.
I forgot to ask, visitor parking, does it have handy accessible stalls?
The visitor, no, but the parking, just the three per building would be accessible. Right. So
for on the whoever's the residents, that would be parking for them.
So we either allow those for the residents if they required them, and then if there's overflow, would be for a visitor.
Oh, well, there is something sort of overflow or whatever.
We have the six accessible stalls. If there was a need for an accessible stall for a client that needed that designated stall, we could assign that to them, or it would be the rest would be overflow.
I see what you said. Yes. Okay.
We'll assign that front row of stalls.
Yeah. So if I'm a visitor and there's a handicap stall open, I could use it.
Yeah. Required to use it.
How many parking stalls again?
Parking stalls.
Like in total.
271, that's correct. 271, that's including all the handicaps.
271?
Yeah.
In other words, they didn't need a parking room?
No, we make bylaw there. So.
Okay, so that's not quite 2 per unit. It's a 1 point something, right?
Well, through the by bylaw is 1.5 per right. stall per stalls okay. per unit.
Okay. All right.
Is there any lighting on the parking at all, or site lighting at all?
Yeah, there will be site lighting. So when we go through our engineering, they'll do their full photometrics of the parking lot to ensure all the lumen plan there is done to ensure that we got proper coverage. So.
Excellent.
Good.
And is there a landscaping in the parking lot area?
Yeah, so I believe with our development permit package, we would have submitted a landscape plan. Actually, that's the one plan I didn't actually bring with me. So there'd be L1 and L-1 and L-2. So that'll have our tree layout, plant layout, and then layouts for the amenity areas and stuff like that. So.
And which building are you? Are you doing this in phases, or?
It'll be built out as is one project.
Okay,
so.
It's one project. So building A, B, and C.
Yeah.
Okay. So. And when are you hoping to put shovel in the ground?
Working through this process right now, and then to start as soon as we can in the spring, pretty much as weather allows. So, yeah, in the new year. So.
Right. And when would the project be finished? Occupancy is for when approximately?
Yeah, you know, depending on when we start, from shoveling the ground to the landscaping completion, this project will take us 10 to 11 months to complete.
So in 2018, folks would
be there? Yes, it would be kind of the spring of 18 is when we'd have people moving in, kind of late winter. Again, depending on the start date.
Right.
I just thought of one more question I wanted to ask. This is a fair way out, but I mean, the development's a fair way out in the north part of our city, but
yeah.
In terms of if I was using a wheelchair, is there a way to get to each building safely? Or?
Yes, so all the sidewalks and entry ramps. And then even from the street, we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 accesses, sidewalk accesses from the sidewalks, and then through the parking lots. you can see by the dashed lines throughout the sidewalks, and then all the front entries are all wheelchair accessible. So, and then all sidewalks you have to build to code to allow for accessibility. So.
There's easy access. Like, I think this whole development, this is just a small piece of a bigger. Plan, but
yeah.
So then it'd be pretty easy to get to. I think the whole development's going to have like active transportation through it somehow.
I can't speak for the developer on what is going on. Kind of
inside our site, there will be an AT path along the main road.
Yeah, that's off the main road.
Exactly. Right?
Yeah. Okay.
What kind of green space is there in this parcel to enjoy? Is there anything?
Within our parcel or the development?
Sorry. This parcel.
So within our parcel, we've kind of allowed for a few areas of amenity on the end of building A. So we have some passive recreation in there with some seating area and some green space, as well as on the back of building A, and then just kind of connectivity to the rest of the development. So.
Right. So the bottom of building A on page L-1, what? Tell me the street again. Like, where's the orientation of this?
The street would be to the south of that, so off the bottom.
What street?
I'm not sure what the name of that street is.
What is street?
Like, basically what I'm asking is what side is backing on to the commercial?
Oh, sorry, what side is backing onto it? That would be the west edge.
So that would be building A?
Building A would be backing
on to
commercial, correct.
That's backing on to the what's going to be commercial in the future, right?
Yeah. So
he's got a 6-foot fence going up there, right?
Yeah, so a privacy fence to screen the
So what's going on building A, the west side, you'll have a fence?
So along the property line, the west property line, we have a 6-foot wood privacy fence.
Okay, and the east property line, nothing?
East, no, because that'll be along the street.
Right.
Street frontage. Okay. So the east and south property lines are street fronting.
Right.
We're kind of on the corner. So the north and west property lines will have fencing.
And folks, when they get picked up from someone, how do you envision that happening?
So in the front of kind of each building, you'll see a no parking on the site plan. So that's kind of our pickup, drop off, 5-minute loading zone kind of spot.
Right. Because it's always dangerous when folks decide to park on the main street, you know, so someone can dart out.
Yes,
you see that they issue.
Yes, they would come into the site to the front of the building they're picking up their guests from, and then we have the kind of the pull in there to allow for the.
And the garbage enclosures. Did we talk about that today?
We have kind of two locations for garbage on the site. One kind of being a little bit central there, and then one. Kind of that will be backing on to along the west property line. Mm-hmm. And each enclosure, again, is in your package. If you look at page A1-2, there'll be a detail of the actual garbage enclosure. So again, 6-foot privacy fence with door enclosure on the front, and then we've kind of raised up the corners to add like a little bit of urban effect to it, so it's not just a standard fence.
Now these sidewalks, I've seen really skinny sidewalks, and I've seen ones that are more generous, and they're better with for people in wheelchairs or if you have a stroller or whatever.
Yeah.
What are we dealing with here?
These are all 5-foot sidewalks.
Okay, and what is our code, I guess? Is it 5 or is it 6?
For the street sidewalk on the public street, it's 6.
It's 6. Okay.
But this one is more internal.
So this is more narrow than a normal sidewalk on a street?
Then, I guess, from a city standard, but on the private property, 5 feet is what we go with on our development.
Right. I can't visualize that right now for some reason. I know when I go around strip malls and stuff, there's some that have really skinny sidewalks, and they're horrible, and there's others that have an oversized, pad or whatever. Those are a lot better.
Yeah.
So do you have room to make anything wider?
Just the couple of the spots, coming in on the front side of the buildings, you end up taking kind of a foot out of the green space in front of the buildings.
Right.
Because
is that green space usable in front of the building or not really?
It's
not really.
Grass. It's it's more just your separation from from living space to public.
Sure. If there's an opportunity to make it wider, I think people would enjoy that. I mean, it is more to snow shovel and more to put in.
Yeah.
In the beginning, cost for you.
There's the cost on that. Through our experience, we've done hundreds of these developments, and we've always found 5 feet to be sufficient for wheelchair accessibility and stuff like that. But
how many inches is that?
48 is 4 feet, so 60 inches.
60 inches. Okay.
Estimate.
Yeah, and I know you've done a lot of developments already, but we're always trying to improve things and make them better.
Yep.
When I look at something like this, it's very hard to get my head around this.
No, for sure.
I like to look at things like this.
Yeah.
On the site, and so I'm relying on you and our planners here to make the proper decisions for the public.
Yep.
Also, with parking spots, I notice in different shopping centers, there's more narrow parking spots, and then there's oversized ones, But I guess some developments have oversized ones, but the narrow ones just don't cut it.
Yeah.
You can barely get out of your car, right? This is probably very tight, though, I imagine. So you're going with the minimum?
Yeah. The parking stalls will have a minimum dimension for a regular car and a small car.
Right.
So we've gone off the city standard for parking stall dimensions.
Sure. Okay, anything further? I see Councillor Pactican pouring over the documents.
Just your eastern frontage there, it doesn't look like there's a fence there. It looks like there's a lot of landscaping. What's adjacent to that side there?
That's the street.
Oh,
there's a street there, yeah.
So
that's street fronting. So your east and south property lines are both street facing.
Okay, fantastic.
So is this what we're going to see on all sides?
Yes.
Right. And so there's no stonework or anything. This is is it hardy board or what do you call it?
This is so there'd be some like on the front entries. So we do a kind of entry canopy with some timber posts, and then we wrap the posts with rock.
Right.
And then we do the exterior. So we've got a kind of three tone exterior, breaking up the top and bottom, and then the bump outs just.
And where is that you're referring to?
So obviously there's the color rendering on the front page, and then if you go to A3-2, again it's kind of in a 2D line work, but it has all of your call outs, and then a box on the bottom that says what all the materials are, so you can kind of reference to one another. Again, it's more of a detailed look, but the 3D rendering would be the actual perspective of what it would look like.
So right now we gave the foundation permit, so that helps you, but you're not going to start that work till spring, right?
The foundation work will start in, spring.
In the spring, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So in the future, just a question for the planners, is A3-2, is it possible to get this kind of paging color in the future?
That would be, what would, if you showed that any color, it would just be the same as the front page.
Right.
But that's just more of a technical call up of the different materials.
Right.
This would be the color of the. Oh, the sides. Sorry. We can create those in color as well. Sorry, I thought you were talking about that.
Just in the future, I'm letting the planners know what I expect to see, and I think my colleagues would like to have as well, some more description and just to know what we're getting in our community. We're North Winnipeg, but we also take pride in how things look.
We want
our community to look nice.
Yeah. No.
Okay, anything further, councillors? Okay. Well, we appreciate you flying all the way here.
Perfect. Actually, I was in town for some other business as well, so it worked out pretty well. So,
yeah.
Thank you for hearing me, and I hope I was able to answer all your questions to go forward with this.
Okay, so nothing further at this time.
Perfect.
I'll ask you to stand down. Could we deal with the item now or later?
Sure, I'll move suspension of rules, Madam Chair.
We already suspended the rules to hear it,
yeah,
so
I'm and
sorry.
That's okay. Item number, it's not on here, so we'll add it as an addendum item.
Item number nine.
You want to read it out into the record, Madam Clerk, the item name?
Plan approval, southeast corner of Phillips Street and Murray Avenue.
Okay. Councillor Pactican, if you could move that on my behalf.
Sure, I'll move the plan approval on your behalf as submitted.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
Fantastic. Best of luck.
Thank you. Back to our
chairperson.
Yes.
Could I suspend the rules? We'll just deal with the traffic report.
Yes.
Pedestrian corridor. Or
right. So we'll move that up. I think we can do that. Yeah.
Okay.
That's item number 8, traffic study of Parr Street and Jefferson Avenue, Mackenzie Street and Hartford. I believe we have someone here from the administration. Colleen Flather, thanks for being here. If you could come forward. Just right here is fine. Yeah. Yeah, so we have to start by 5:30. Yeah.
You don't have to call the hearing to order till
5:30. We'll just deal with this item and maybe deal with Laurie so she can go to the next person. Okay. Councillor Eady,
I just had some questions just about the report, because it looks like your division has looked at it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't quite know what the numbers were. I bet you there was. I don't know that there was a lot of pedestrian traffic at Mackenzie and Hartford.
No, there was about half of what's required for warrant to install a crosswalk.
Like just a regular crosswalk with painted lines and a sign, right?
Right. That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. That's what I figured. But I just want to ask some questions about Jefferson. So there was a study there.
That's right.
And there was enough people there to warrant?
Yes. So the warrant is 15 EAUs, equivalent adult units,
mm-hmm.
15 per hour on average over a minimum 7-hour period.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the warrant is 15, and it was at 23. So it's...
And there wasn't... It was pretty heavy around the rush hours, right? Like,
well, it's the 7 hours, so it's
typically... Well, it's the full 7 hours. Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. like, I think this is okay. However, is there anything related to putting in a pedestrian crosswalk near a railway crossing?
This
bar is only about, what is it, about 50 meters from railway track?
I did consider the railway crossing.
Yeah.
There's enough room for the speed of the roadway.
Okay.
To install the crosswalk.
There is, okay. Mm-hmm. So, and it was saying there is a minimal cost associated with it?
Yeah, I think it's $600.
Yeah, so what I didn't understand about the report, it wasn't a recommendation. Like, there was no real recommendation. It was just a report coming back. So this is going to go to Infrastructure Renewal and Public Works.
The recommendation of this report is says to install a pedestrian crosswalk at Jefferson and Parr.
Oh, it is to install?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and it says Hartford and McKenzie will remain unchanged.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to try to deal with that a different way. But
We try to look as well, like when I evaluate things, I try and evaluate them from as many angles as possible to see if we can make changes. McKenzie and Hartford, it wasn't close enough to the school to include it as a school crosswalk.
Yeah, yeah.
School crosswalks have a different warrant. It was still too far away.
Yeah.
So.
No, that's okay. Most of the students there are bus. That's why you probably didn't see as many pedestrians there as well. Your department doesn't look at this, but like if we wanted to slow it down, maybe we could do like a bulb up at McKenzie to make it more.
McKenzie and Harvard. Yeah, we can look at speed on there, because the disposition was just it was for a crosswalk specifically. Yeah. We just counted people and vehicles. We didn't do a speed. But we could definitely do a speed through there and see if, you know, we could look at.
Just so you know, that road is about to have a major renewal.
Okay.
In
That's
2017.
A good time to do stuff. Absolutely.
So, anyway, but yeah, so there's how many? In 7 hours, 15?
The warrant is 15.
And there was less than that, yeah.
There was eight.
Eight, yeah, okay.
So it's.
Yeah.
What I'd call not close.
And there probably wasn't a lot of automobiles either, right? Because the roads are really bad. Anyway, it's okay.
Well, I don't have it in front of me. The volume for the vehicles was well within limits. Yeah, but I can. We can look certainly at doing a speed study on Hartford.
It's pretty slow right now. It's really bad.
Yeah.
Anyway, but okay.
But we can look at other traffic calming. You know, maybe we can have a conversation about that.
Yeah, I was gonna.
Before the rehab goes ahead.
Yeah.
We can include it in that project cost potentially.
I'm gonna put in a request to the right person at Public Works to look at when they're designing this renewal to look at.
Sure.
I think Bulba. I don't. Circles or whatever, but I think a bulb would just sort of narrow it a bit so people slow down.
Sure.
Yeah.
I would probably start talking with Rod Hamilton first, and then he'll come to me and ask about traffic calming. But
great. Okay. Yeah. Sounds good.
Okay.
If you could do a bulb, I'd come back.
Okay. I'll.
No raised intersections around there. They did win at Powers, and I have nothing but complaints. Oh, you know about it.
Oh, okay. Yes, I know. I came in afterwards, but I've heard it.
All right, thank you.
Appreciate it. You're welcome. Yes.
So this, just to confirm then, this report's going on to IRPW recommending a pedestrian crosswalk at Parr and Jefferson.
That's right.
Excellent, thanks.
You're welcome.
The parents there will be very happy. I'll move the report and...
Sorry, the recommendation from the port is that it be received, or is for information only.
Did it get changed?
Yeah.
Huh.
It just says this report is for information only.
See, that's what I said. It says it's for information only, so that's what I was concerned about.
Why is that?
I think because...
Well, just to be clear, I'm moving the...
We can move a new recommendation.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm moving the recommendation to install...
Yeah, why are the implications just for information, though? I don't understand.
Well, because community committee...
I think it might have been the way the disposition was worded. Let me just double check. I know there was emails on this one.
Because if you're recommending something, it should be in here. We would send it up to Public Works, and then we would move it forward from there.
I can see what you mean in the way DISCO was just said report back.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because I think the way, because of the disposition, the way it was worded,
okay,
we had to just give information back. I mean, this is...
Well, to us, yeah.
Because it's warranted and because it's such a small cost, we don't have a problem with it going in. But that's not how they asked for it.
Right.
So we have to put that in as a recommendation, as for information.
I just want to qualify this, though. It's IRPW Standing Committee who makes the decision if this goes ahead or not, right?
Yeah.
Because it was, it's a report that was required out of this committee, right? But...
So,
I mean, they can...
I just want to make sure it shows up on the IRP agenda saying we recommend installing this instead of recommending receiving it as information.
Well, we should move it forward that way.
Yeah, move
it forward. You can say you did not concur in the recommendation of the public service and what you would like to move.
Yeah.
But that sounds negative because it's not that we don't concur. It's just that we're taking a report and now we're taking it a step further, right?
I just want to make sure it's clear when it gets to IRPW.
Yeah, well, I'm on there. That's why I'm asking all the questions.
Well, no, because I've had a local sidewalk improvement go through IRPW.
Mm-hmm.
It was recommended. It never got done. So I want to make sure it's... So I'm just going to move this report because it wasn't on the last IRPW standing committee meeting.
But when we move it forward, what's the financial implication? Would it be get money through the budget process or you have some money tagged for this?
Typically installation of crosswalks just goes under street maintenance because it's so low.
So we would put it to the
like
budget per cent cost,
or
what would we do, Councilor Reedy? Would we put it to the budget process?
No,
like
no, it's
they have money.
It's, they have an annual sign budget.
Okay.
You actually have an annual sign budget to do like loading zones and all kinds of stuff, right?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's all. Yeah.
It's
only
six.
I
what
see.
Would you like a motion?
It's a minimum cost.
It's because it's a crosswalk, not a corridor.
I'm
just moving that I don't receive this as just information. I'm moving to concur with the recommendation within here, which is to install a pedestrian crosswalk. That's the right terminology, right?
Now, Colleen, could I ask as well, when this item comes to Public Works, would you be attending there so there's no confusion around it, or make sure that the director's aware?
Yeah, Louis will be attending, I'm
okay,
certain.
So making sure that he's aware of the history behind it?
Yeah, okay.
Well, you're on the standing
yes,
committee.
Yes, exactly. right, good. Okay, good. So we'll deal with that item now. You move the motion?
Yeah, I moved it.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried. Thank you, Colleen.
You're welcome.
And, I should have said, what we're voting on, though, is we are concurring, though, with the no installation at McKenzie and Hartford. Should be clear about that, too. Sorry.
So, item number one, extension of hours, Culture Days Manitoba.
Can I just, before we do that, yes. Just calling good to meet you, I just wanted to say we have a couple of disposition items in the system. I don't know if you're aware of them, but there was a couple of studies that were in the system a couple of years, or maybe a year ago. I don't know if you knew that. But one of them was on Logan and one of them was on Dufferin.
Those are regional streets, so Stephen Chapman deals with that.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, so
okay,
I don't get to deal with those. But
okay,
fantastic. Yeah, sorry.
Okay, no problem.
Actually, I'm going to call item number six, if we could, right now, the community incentive grant for the Garden City Community Center.
Oh, right, yeah.
But delegations are over.
I move that...
We'll suspend the rules.
I move to suspend the rules, yes.
Okay.
Do you guys think you'll be done the regular agenda?
Yes, we'll be done. I think we'll be done. Yeah. So can we suspend the rules to have the delegation come forward in case we have some questions? Lori, if you could come to the end of the table. So item number six is a community incentive grant. The Garden City Community Center is requesting some funds to do some work on the soccer fields.
Yes.
To reconfigure some soccer fields. You are asking for $125,000.
Correct.
Okay. And of those, the total project cost is $250,000, I believe?
Yes, $250,000.
So my understanding is that you did get a grant from the federal government?
Yes,
under the
Canada
150.
Yeah, we have $125,000 from them, and we need to match it with...
Okay,
with
so you have $125,000 from them. So you're coming to us with a request of $125,000, but you have $45,000. From the club, I understand, and speaking with Martino Vergata.
Yeah, we have $20,000 from the WSF project, the indoor soccer project.
Right.
They're giving us $20,000 because part of their project was on our fields. And then we can, the club can sustain up to $25,000 ourselves.
Now, so there's a remaining $80,000 that's needed. And I know your group has met with the three of us counselors. We're wanting to help. Now, these fields will be operational next spring, I understand. Okay.
Yes.
So given the positive approval today, I know when speaking with Martino, there would be some kind of event maybe for the community before that first game is played. So if you could invite the three of us counselors to that.
Absolutely.
And let's schedule that in for the spring. There was also some talk that your group would apply for a community center renovation grant.
Right. We will. I'm skeptical if we'll get any, but.
Well, we want to try for that. So the money that we're going to be moving today is going to be subject to you applying for that grant.
Okay.
And the deadline is, I believe, this Friday or Saturday.
Okay.
And I think it could be a very good fit for your group. You can get information from Clyde Boydman or from GCWCC.
Yeah.
So today's Tuesday, so you have all the information here that's been submitted into the package, so it shouldn't be that much work to pull that together. So the funds that I know Councillor Eady and I have had a conversation, so when we approve the funds, it'll be subject to your group applying for the renovation grant.
Okay.
And Madam Clerk, Councillor Eady would like to have some money from the old Kildonan fund to borrow it until next year. Does that work? That can be done.
You know what? I'm actually not sure.
Okay. Well, we're going to do it. I think you've done it before.
We're going to do this. So
okay.
It's, so Councillor Kaktikan knows how to move such a motion.
Okay.
When he was working with Councillors Lazarenko and O'Shaughnessy, they did
Ingo
it all the time.
All figured out. So it's is it 20,000 then and 60 or 60 from me?
So the motion, chairperson then is to move 60,000 from the old Kildonan Community Center Grant Fund. And 20,000 from the Minarski incentive grant borrowed through
Kildonan fund until 2017 funds become available.
I'll figure out the wording.
Okay.
Well, and I'd like to make a contribution as well. Just
Then let's shrink it.
Well, shrink mine.
Okay.
So Councillor Patrick,
let's do another motion. Okay. I'm not moving my motion then. Okay.
I don't mind contributing.
But you got to borrow too.
Do you need the balance sheet?
Yeah.
There is a borrowing from Old K.
Yeah.
Well, Old K needs it for the project coming next year, so.
Moving 80,000 from the old Kildonan.
No, it's not 80.
Well, it is, but
right.
The split is X amount to be. Actually, it is moving. We have to move the 80 from your fund this year.
Well, I think you should say what you want to give and say that Old Kildonan will be debited. And
that's
right now.
So 15, I can go
15. Just to make it
50, so 15. That lowers hers to 45. So we're moving a total of 80,000.
Yeah.
So 45.
From the old Kildonan, just listen to me, from the old Kildonan CIGP fund with 20,000 to be paid back to Old Kildonan from Minarski and 15,000 to be paid back from
Point Douglas,
subject to the Garden City Community Center applying for the GCWCC renovation
grant fall intake, which is due in October.
Which is due,
So, Madam Clerk, it's 80 in total, 20 from Minarski, 15 from Point Douglas and 45 from Old Kildonan. Okay, but it's all subject to, as Councillor Reedy said, the group applying for the Community Center Renovation Grant, the fall intake, which is due this week.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're hoping some money will come through there and then we'll be reducing through here. Yeah, okay, great. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carry.
Good work.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, that was easy.
Okay, so we can
adjourn until. Move adjournment and do the hearing?
I think we can keep moving.
Oh, I have a new item.
We still got to do the agenda.
Sorry.
The Culture Days Manitoba extension of hours, I believe we're ratifying that.
Yeah.
All in favor?
I'm sorry, what's this one?
Culture Days.
Oh, yeah, aye.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried. The occasional liquor permit, North Forge Technology Exchange?
Yeah, this is an...
Ratifying that?
Yeah, we move to ratify the decision made by email.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried. Number three, per capita grant, Sinclair Park Community Center?
Yeah, I'll move $350 from Point Douglas.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried. Item number four, per capita grant, Knights of Columbus?
We have to have the hearing by 5:30, right?
Yes, we'll do that.
7 minutes.
Madam Chairperson?
Yes.
May I suggest that we take a break and then...
Yes, we will do that.
Because there's some other walk-on items.
Yeah.
So I'll move, we'll have a recess right now then?
Yeah.
Yeah, short recess.
Okay, we'll have a recess and we'll reconvene at 5:30 for the public hearings. That'll be in 5 minutes.
Okay, make sure that it comes later than 5:29.
Okay, because we do have to start the meeting right
now. Otherwise we can't continue.
The only reason I suggest that I'm not going for sure, I have to go to Washington.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Debbie Sharma, and I'd like to bring the Lord Selkirk West Caledonian Community Committee meeting to order. This is the public hearing portion of our meeting for October 11, 2016, and I'm your chairperson today. Also joining me is Councillor Ross Eady from the Minarski Ward, Councillor Mike Pactican from the Point Douglas Ward, who will be here momentarily, Noah Yock and Femi Ojo from the Planning Department, and our clerk, Kate McMillan, mixing your name up, your last name, sorry, Kate. Okay, and we have one item on the agenda, and I just want to wait a moment as Councillor Pactican will be here in just one moment. Yes, it's a item number one, it's a variance for 603 Redwood Avenue. And I'll let you read the process.
All persons who wish to speak or receive notice of the hearing body's decision or recommendation must fill out a public representation form and submit it to me as soon as possible. Copies of this form can be found at the registration table. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, the process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. This is the public hearing process brochure, copies of which are available at the registration table. The brochure contains an overview of the process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing. As information, all public hearings are recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the public hearing is concluded, please contact the City Clerk's Department. Item 1 is a variance at 603 Redwood Avenue under file DAV133553 of 2016D.
Okay. And the applicant, Madam Clerk? Okay. Is Ms. Ruby Lee, is it?
Yes.
Yeah. Would you like to come forward, please? Did I pronounce that correctly? Lee?
Yes.
Okay. Welcome. If you could state your name and address for the record.
Ruby Lee, 465 Gary.
Okay. And you have the floor to make your presentation now.
The variance is for existing fire hall that located at 603 Redwood. We did an addition to that fire hall, adding two bays. But what happened was that due to a mistake in our drawing, or it was short of the required side yard. It was supposed to be 10 feet, and it ends up around 7. I believe the mistake is occurred because of our existing building location plan was in error, so we just kind of took the existing plan and just add on to that.
So,
you have Councillor Eady? Yeah, I was going to say the days of being built, right? How did it come to your attention that you were actually over a couple of feet?
It was just a regular site meeting. We went out and looked around the building. It's sort of already, the walls are all up, and we looked, and it looked kind of not like 10 feet. So we went and measured it, and it's like 7.
Okay. So this doesn't come from any of the residents in the immediate area?
No. And the contractor didn't even tell us it was in there. Nobody seemed to notice.
Okay. I just wanted to confirm if it was that I know you're from municipal accommodations, so
yes.
There's some residents that have issues with that building. But anyway, I think that just clarifies it. So. It's and so the west side, actually, is there a vacant lot to the west of this?
No.
There is a house, right?
Yeah, there's a
house. Okay. Okay. But this is not anything substantial? Mm. Like the clearance of 10 feet was for what reason? Because on a residential lot, it's only 4 feet, right? But this is a C1, requires a side yard of 10 feet?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's the requirement, 10 feet.
Yeah, I can just clarify, there was a vacant city-owned lot, and there was a rezoning, I think it was last year, to allow for the expansion.
Oh, a rezoned the C1 to allow for it, right.
Right, because the vacant lot was zoned, I think, R1, so they needed a consistent zoning. So
right, that's where it was. Okay.
Yeah, it was our vacant lot.
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Nothing further, Councillor Reedy? Okay. There's no one else here in support. Okay, no one here in opposition. So it would be your chance to come back here if there's any further questions. I don't see any, so I'll ask you to stand down and we'll make our decision, or we may have questions for the administration. Thank you, Ms. Lee. Okay, is there anyone else here that would wishes to speak that didn't have the opportunity? Just have to ask the question. Okay, seeing none.
There's no need for the applicant questions? To come back.
So no.
I'm ready to move a motion.
Okay, Councillor Reedy.
Oh, actually, I should get to the right spot. Sorry.
Page 4.
Helps. I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Contrary, carried.
I move that in accordance with subsection 247.3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance A is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. B does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenity, use, safety, convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway. C is the minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and D is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated. And the supporting comments are, I don't know, it's a minimal area. It is a substantial, it's still, I think, a substantial side yard of 7 feet, so the people have learned to live with the noise of the fire paramedic service that operates out of this building, so I don't see that it has any adverse effects or anything.
So. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to what?
Quick. You missed that, and the variance be approved in that last.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Oh, whoops, sorry. Oops. Oh, yeah, that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in, and the variance be approved. Sorry.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
Sorry, that broke down weird with my voice up, but I move that public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered.
Okay, and that concludes our public hearings today. Thank you, Ms. Lee. Now we're back to the regular agenda. We were on item number 4, per capita grant for the Knights of Columbus. Okay, Councillor Pakican, could you move $400 on my behalf?
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried. Item number 5 is a per capita grant for the Shaheed Udham Singh Cultural and Sports Club. If you could move $125 on my behalf, Councillor Reedy.
I shall move $125. I will move. Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
Community Center grant.
Okay. The item number 7, Land Dedication Reserve Fund. The department does not feel that at this point they can move forward. They'd like to do it in the spring because of the weather. So I would like to bring this forward at that time.
Sure. Is there a specific month that I can put on the agenda for? March 2017?
Okay.
Or April?
What if we brought it forward in March? We could always... Yeah, yeah, sure. March would be perfectly fine. Okay, so Councillor Reedy?
I move that we deal with this land dedication reserve request in March. What was it,
2017,
yes.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Contrary, carried. Do we have other items? I do. Do others?
I'm going to suspend the rules, Madam Chair, to hear other items.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
So I have one, we already dealt with the plan approval. I have one here in regard to a motion to waive any building development fees related to the, actually, what is it? The Little Stars Playhouse. Sorry. I don't know, did you all get that motion or? I think it was emailed.
I don't think I saw it. It should be in your packages.
Oh, okay, sure.
Sorry, it's basically a daycare that's being set up by the by Women Healing for Change Inc. And it's to be at trying to waive any fees that are possible. They are not for profit. We had already moved the motion. The city and council already confirmed that we would sell this two lots actually to this organization so they could develop and build this, and that was done about a year ago or more, and now they're moving forward and finding out that it's difficult to pay all the fees. So this is simply allowed under, can't remember the bylaw?
It's the Planning, Development, and Building Fees bylaw.
Yeah, thank you.
No problem.
Yeah, and so this is just a motion. It would go to Property and Development. Community makes a recommendation, and then it goes on to PD, D, whatever. You know that committee?
Yeah,
and so it's just, therefore, be it resolved that under that bylaw that they waive any applicable fees or whatever.
Okay.
So you're moving that? Okay. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Madam Clerk, who is the Canadian Community Economic Development Network from?
Councillor Edie.
Edie? Okay, go ahead. The Canadian Community Economic Development Network? Are you bringing that forward?
Canadian?
You actually, this came directly from the organization, I believe.
Seven. Okay. Oh, how much are they looking for?
$500.
Oh.
But they received $200 last year.
Oh, okay.
Oh, from City Center.
They didn't even ask me, did they?
Well, you could review it and bring it forward.
Anyway,
you can lay it over.
No, you know what I'm going to do? I believe I have, 200 and something of it.
I can double check. $233.
Okay, so I'm going to move $133 to the SEDNET.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Councillor Papakan, would you like to have the floor now?
Sure. Thank you, Madam Chair. I'd like to move from $500 from the Flint Douglas per capita for the 4th Annual Unemployed Youth Africa Incorporated Dinner.
Is this the one that you reached out to us about?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I'll help you out with the project.
Okay, super.
Yeah.
So
sounds
basically
like an interesting project.
Yeah, what they're doing is there's a lot of youth that are highly educated back in the Nigerian mm-hmm. country. And so what this project does is it helps create they fundraise, because what they do is they provide microloans to these folks back home. Mm-hmm. There's a huge Nigerian community here, and they're trying to stimulate the economy there. So this is something that's important for them. I just trying to support.
So we'll do our support together, for the...
Oh, sure, the ad?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, okay. So then...
So which one were you looking at?
Do you want to go... it's a full-page ad, so we can go half. Do you want to go half on it?
Yeah.
Or how much were you, looking at contributing? I gotta go 500 anyway. So.
Right.
So you want to just do what? You want to do a quarter page at 100?
Quarter page is not 100. Oh, you mean?
Sorry. What is a quarter page?
Yeah. What are you looking? Because you seem like you're very involved in this project. I do want to support you.
200. Yeah. Do you want to do 200 on this?
Sure. Okay. So 200 from the old Kelowna is what you're saying, or 200 in total?
Yeah. Okay. No. No. Yeah. I'm gonna go 500, and you're gonna add 200.
700 total.
Yeah. So are we separate then, or together?
Separate.
Okay, well, I don't have, I think I was just going to be in there with you, or do you want to go together? I think Vivian had emailed us about
that. Fair enough. So let's go, so I'll go 400, you'll go 100. Is that what you want to do? 150, I'll go 350.
Sure.
Okay.
Sounds right for a full page.
Yeah, we'll just figure out the whatever.
Happy to support you.
So 350 from Point Douglas, okay. Madam Chair, and 150 from Old Kildonan. I'll move that.
Okay, great.
Question?
And I have the Itcha group that is having their annual event. They're asking for some support. Councillor Reedy, if you can move $600.
We didn't vote on the last one.
So. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
No.
And that was the, I want to write that down. That was how much? 150 from OK?
Yeah. Okay, now you have a per capita grant request, Madam Chair?
Yes, the ITCHA group, if you could move 600 on my behalf. Madam Clerk, you have the paperwork.
Yep. I'll move 600 from the Old Cologne per capita towards, what was it?
The ITCHA group, the Indo-Canadian.
Oh, the Indo, right, yes.
Cultural and Heritage Association. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried. I'd like to move $845 to the Macbeth House Center. Historical home in the Old Kildonan Ward, and they're going to be having afternoon teas with guest speakers and tours of the home. $845, Councillor Reedy, on my behalf.
I'll move that on your behalf. It's a great place.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried. Is there anything more, Madam Clerk?
No.
Mm.
You should check that.
I do not believe so, no.
Okay.
I move adjournment.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's right by the river, too.
There.
I
gotta go there. I like to go to all these museum things.
I've been to Ross House
Museum. I've been to Seven.